Penguin Audio presents Rocket Men, written by Craig Nelson, read by Richard McGonagle. Dedicated to the 400,000 men and women of Apollo, you made the dream come true. Then what am I when flying? The body substance which I can see with my eyes and feel with my hands? Or am I this realization? This greater understanding which dwells within it, yet expands through the universe outside, a part of all existence, powerless but without the need for power, immersed in solitude, yet in contact with all creation. Charles Lindbergh, The Spirit of St. Louis. Ad astra per aspera. A rough path leads to the stars. Apollo 1 Memorial, Kennedy Space Center. In 1969, a few months after Apollo 11 landed on the moon, Rhode Island's Senator John Pastore was interrogating Fermilab physicist Robert Wilson at a Senate hearing on whether the federal government should spend $250 million to build a new collider. The senator wanted to know, would this collider add to the security of the country? No, sir, I don't believe so, Wilson answered. Senator Pastore, nothing at all? Mr. Wilson, nothing at all. Senator Pastore, it has no value in that respect. Mr. Wilson, it only has to do with the respect with which we regard one another, the dignity of men, our love of culture. It has to do with, are we good painters, good sculptors, great poets? I mean, all the things we really venerate in our country and are patriotic about. It has nothing to do directly with defending our country, except to make it worth defending. Part 1. Chapter 1. Behemoth. On May 20, 1969, at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, a 363-foot, 30-story-high, black-and-white Saturn V rocket, known as AS-506, was painstakingly trundled 5 miles across the raging heat and searing green of Central Florida's eastern coast by an 11-man Kennedy Space Center crew aboard the world's largest land vehicle, a 6-million-pound tank-wheeled crawler out of NASA's Vehicle Assembly Building. Itself a 129 million cubic foot edifice so massive that its steel accordion doors were 45 stories high, and without its 10,000-ton air conditioner, interior clouds would form under its 525-foot high ceiling, and it would rain. An enormous creation of white ship and red derrick, the rocket and its mated launch tower, a 12-million-pound engineering and technological Goliath, moved so slowly from where they had been assembled to their destination that progress could not be tracked by human eye. Instead, they would be noted at one point, and then a few hours later at another, the sight accompanied by a small shock, the shock of a great red, white, and black skyscraper coming to life and advancing imperceptibly across the Florida sawgrass swampland. The crawler at the rocket's base was in itself such a dramatic piece of engineering legerdemain that it even impressed Kennedy Launch Operations Director and former West Point tackle, Rocco Patrone. Somebody in our shop came up with the idea of using giant tracked machines like those used in strip mining. What evolved was the unique crawler, or more politely, transporter. As built by Ohio's Marion Power Shovel Company, the crawler took shape with 8 tracks, each 7 by 41 feet, with cleats like a Sherman tank, except that each cleat weighed a ton. Mounted over these 8 tracks was the platform, bigger than a baseball diamond, on which the Apollo Saturn V and its mobile launcher would ride majestically from VAB to pad at 1 mile per hour. The package weighed 9,000 tons, 2/3 cargo, 1/3 crawler. NASA itself manufactures very little of what it flies. Instead, for Apollo 11, it relied on 12,000 American corporations and 400,000 employees, almost all of whose output ended up at the Vehicle Assembly Building, VAB, which Patron called an intricate machine that assembled the vehicle in its final phases. The Saturn V rocket's bottom stage was built by Boeing at the Michoud Assembly Factory in New Orleans. Barged down the Mississippi River, around the Florida Peninsula, and through a series of canals to the VAB, the great shimmering reflecting pool that has graced so many NASA launch photos, is in fact a turning basin for its arriving barges. The booster's Stage 2 was built by North American Rockwell in Seal Beach, California, shipped through the Panama Canal to be test-fired at NASA's Mississippi facility, and then shipped to Kennedy. Stage 3 originated with Douglas in Sacramento, California, and was flown to Kennedy via Aero Space Line's specially manufactured version of the Boeing Stratocruiser, the Super Guppy. The Guppy had been created solely through the efforts and finances of Aero's founder, John Conroy, who, against many doubters, insisted he could turn a generic cargo jet into a carrier that would fit NASA's stratospheric requirements. The agency had previously tried using zeppelins to transport its enormous rockets, an experiment that did not end well. That same plane carried the command and service modules from North American's Downey, California plant, while the lunar module, as light a ship as any in history, traveled by train and truck from Grumman's factory in Bethpage, New York, to Florida. After seeing their bucket arrive factory fresh from manufacturer North American Aviation in its blue packing sheet, the Apollo 9 crew had named their command module Gumdrop and their lunar module Spider for its arachnid appearance. When Apollo 10 in turn christened their ships Charlie Brown and Snoopy, Assistant Administrator for Public Affairs Julian Scheer wrote Manned Spacecraft Center Director George M. Lowe to suggest that perhaps the Apollo 11 crew might consider being less flippant in naming their craft. Scheer, in fact, would end up suggesting Columbia for the CM, while Jim Lovell, Neil Armstrong's backup commander, would recommend Eagle for the LEM. Both ideas would be adopted. As each rocket part arrived at Kennedy, it was individually inspected, mated to its nethers in the VAB, and the whole then given a plugs-in test, a complete simulation of every dial, switch, pump, light, fan, valve, and motor that would be used on the mission. The near sadism that had marked the earliest rounds of psychological and physical testing of the Mercury astronauts now found its match in the torturing of these machines. Columbia and Eagle and their environmental, communications, electrical, and rocket subsystems were subjected to fire, ice, collision, shocks, vibration, dust, rain, and 587,500 forms of inspection. After reaching the distant loneliness of Pad 39A's octagon-shaped concrete slab built hard against the sea, Saturn V Apollo 11 underwent a flight readiness test. Then its tanks were pumped with liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen, jet-grade kerosene, and hydrogen peroxide at 10,000 gallons a minute for 4 hours and 37 minutes, followed by the 5-day, 93-hour countdown to liftoff. At every step, a horde of technicians swarmed over the great Leviathan, pumping and probing, tightening and reconnecting, moaning with frustration, or quietly moving on to the next of the tasks that seemed as endless as the stars in the night. NASA's astronauts may have been widely admired for their daring and their courage, but these pad workers, under constant threat from enormous machines and lethal gases, were just as brave. Together, they shared a utopian and impossible dream that they would imminently send, for the first time in history, men to the moon. Rocco Patron. By the time of Apollo 11, the number of printed pages that were required to check out a space vehicle actually surpassed 30,000. In our testing, we had a building block approach, very logical, very methodical. You built each test on the last test, and the whole sequence expanded in the process. The rough-and-tumble patron had been working with the terse and severe Kennedy Space Center director Kurt Debus ever since the very first Redstone rocket was launched in 1953. Patron was then an Army Ordnance officer, and the two had risen side by side to become heads of NASA's Florida Directorate. Kurt Debus was one of the original members of the Wernher von Braun rocket team. At the close of the war, his U.S. Army records described him as an ardent Nazi, known to have denounced his colleagues to the Gestapo. At NASA, he was notoriously fastidious, a chief so enamored of cleanliness that he would personally tidy up his underlings' desks, while New Yorker Patron was just as famous for decimating a worker who didn't give it his all. To get from Alan Shepard's ballistic lob to Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin's moonwalk in less than a decade, the American team needed a front line of just this type of rough management in the theater of war that was the space race. Over the previous 7 years, Debus's German émigré colleagues had created a booster for Armstrong's Saturn that was 50 times as powerful as John Glenn's Atlas, and most crucially, would have the remarkable legacy, unlike almost every other rocket in history, of never self-immolating on the pad. Heroic engineering at its best. One wonder to me was that no Saturn V rocket ever blew up, admitted Apollo 11 command module pilot Michael Collins. I mean, that just surprised the pee willy out of me. NASA researcher Jim Slade remembered, I heard Neil Armstrong one time say that today they're shocked when the shuttle...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.